old warehouse. We climb up and find it's actually a large reservoir with a big fence and an electric fence inside. We can walk along parts of the reservoir. There's another fence that prevents us falling over the limestone cliffs. There's a great view over the Indian Ocean. There's the car park below us and the Indian Ocean. Look, one can even see the Fremantle Wharf with the large cranes for loading and unloading containers. The electric fence surrounding the reservoir is clearly apparent. A very slow panoramic view showing the size of the reservoir. I wonder what parts of MOSMAN Park and Peppermint Grove are covered. Peter told me how he used to go swimming in it as a youth, once it covered over in those days. It is quite a structure, and they clearly do not want visitors in the vicinity. The mayor of MOSMAN Park declared that the area was a disgrace and advocated fixing the area to improve visitors. Just to give you the feel for the area, there's a monument on the left and the lighthouse on the right. This is a long telescopic view of the hill taken from the railway station. The limestone cliffs that are fenced off both above and below, and which are filled with caves, can be clearly apparent here. There used to be limestone works cut away at one time. Another view of the lighthouse with the limestone cliffs. A long distance view of the lighthouse showing its modern conversion with antennas for mobile phones. Shame that everything is fenced and surrounded by barbed wire, and the reasons are apparent with the tagging and vandalism. There's been recent controversy about extending the mobile tower on top of the lighthouse. Local residents are opposed. The lighthouse at night, it's clearly a highly directional beacon to aid ships to enter a harbor. A view of the Indian Ocean from the lighthouse on Monument Hill. The lighthouse on Loch Ness Island, nearly 20 kilometers away, is clearly visible. The monument itself. It's not really a monument, I learned. The obelisk, or the little stone at top, was placed as a navigation device for ships and as a trigonometric point for surveyors. I don't really understand quite the details of how they used it, but it was a marker.
Yeah, this clock is really hard to read, but it says something like that the obelisk here was built between 1878 and 1880 by convict labour to replace an earlier navigation mark and survey mark. And it goes on to describe its checkered history where in 1920 something the water supply built a concrete lined reservoir and then enlarged the reservoir to encompass the the obelisk. Yeah, and it then goes on to say that it was in 1983 when the water supply refurbished and covered the reservoir that they moved the obelisk stone by stone and so that it was no longer in the middle of the reservoir.
The Australian pilot in the 1930s notes the white obelisk combustion hill is conspicuous. The hill is 70 meters, 230 feet high. Peter reads the plaque. It's engraved, but it's so faded, it's very difficult to make out and impossible to photograph. A little research on the web found that the obelisk above the hill is constructed as a pinpoint for a hydrographic survey undertaken in 1872 to 1874. Continued to be used as a survey point until 1967 and was also used as a sea mark. 1934-35, a reservoir was built around the obelisk. 1983, the obelisk was moved 48 meters southwest outside the reservoir and restored. During restoration, it was placed on a large limestone base to raise the structure to its original height. The base is of such large dimensions that it diminishes the impact of the obelisk. The place is entered on the Town of Mosman Park Municipal Inventory. It's a shame the place is surrounded with barbed wire and there's broken glass all over. The state heritage of state housing is clearly apparent, even though property values now are over $1 million for a 400 square meter block. A view of the obelisk when it was located inside the reservoir. Notice the reservoir once it covered. The grand opening of the reservoir in 1934, I think. Peter begins his search for the geocache, and he looks around the monument. I admire the view over the Indian Ocean. Peter heads for the bushes. Be careful with snakes. Some of the local species of snakes, like the dugite and tiger snake, are notoriously venomous, and they like bushland. It's not accessible for a wheelchair, so I wait. Success! Peter has found the geocache, a lunchbox wrapped in a garbage bag. Look at that smile. This man is very happy.
Okay, another geocache. What have we got? A compact disc with an Olympus camera driver. We've got a green lion. A 100 meg zip drive. A film quiz book. I'm definitely not swapping these. And, oh yeah. The MOSMAN 5 geocache. Oh, the pencil sharpener. And a Beijing Observatory geocoin, trackable at geocaching.com.
So we can't take that?
Oh no, no. I don't think we're going to Beijing. I think that's for, I think that's meant to make it to the Beijing Olympics. I'm here. Okay,
We better mark the logbook.
We leave a prize, in this case a 35 amp car fuse, but take nothing. We admire the view and prepare to go home. It's been a great outing and an exploration into history. Have a good day, dear viewers, and thanks for watching this production.